were your interests in Courtauld came from? How did the bar be developed to that solution?
Well, I suspect, like a lot of people, it started from reading landscape into art and watching Civilisation. I was a schoolboy and I found myself taken on this grand tour. And I think it gave me a framework, a bit like reading Kubrick. And it was I was enthralled by it. So that, I think, is where it started.
But both the writing and the
yes, I read Landscape into Art, the first book, and I was fascinated by the methodology of the book. I don't think I'd ever read an art history book in that kind of, it seemed like an interesting way of treating landscape, because it had always been done either chronologically or by national school, and this for thematic, yes. I thought it was very engaging. Of course, it was also beautifully written, and this is one of the reasons I think why so many people who really were not art historians always read Clark, because he can be read as literature. And that wonderful opening passage of Anthony Barb, "You are surrounded with things which we have not made," and so forth and so forth. You know, he's a master of prose, following Ruskin, who Ayla knows so much about.
And the biography, when did you start working on that?
I started on it about, I've lost all sense of time now, 5 years ago. And I was 3 years really solidly doing archival work, a lot of it at the Tate. It was incredibly good luck. I lived 10 minutes from Tate Britain. But I'd have done it if it had been in, Honolulu. It just happened, it was where I live. And then I was a year in other archives. You know, there's a lot of material in America, in about 8-10 places in America. And then Oxford, and then all these specialist archives, like the IBA archive at Bournemouth. The difficult one, of course, was the Kew archive for the Ministry of Information, which filled this room. That was quite a challenge. And then it was a year of writing. But it was a wonderful experience. And of course, a lot of it was involved trying to interview people, catching people while they were still alive. I was very lucky that nearly all the Civilisation crew, apart from Michael Gilbert, were alive. And although most of them were beginning to find they couldn't remember things, and Peter Matanian, who was the second producer on Civilisation, lives in Menair, and we talked on the phone, and he said, "Come stay." I flew out to stay, and he had no idea who I was or why I was there. Dear sweet man that he was, he said, "Do come in." "Well, yes, how long are you staying for?" "Two nights, actually." And he couldn't remember anything at first. So the following morning, and we did nothing that night, I said, "Well, look, let's go through the DVDs." And he started watching them, and suddenly it all came back. And it was just magical, the material he gave me. And the same happened with Ann Turner, who did produce the Man Measure of All Things. The one person with a perfect memory, absolutely remembered everything, was the most astonishing discovery of all, was Michael Reddington, who was the man who taught Clark to do television in the late 1950s. And he was also 10 minutes away from me in Westminster. And he was in his 90s, and he had a memory like sharp as a bell, and he completely put flesh on all the early television programs. And he was an absolutely enchanting man, and I'm sorry to say he died about 2 weeks ago. I went to his funeral. He'd been an actor, and he'd been a theatre director, but he went to ATV, ITV, to be in charge of what's called the toddler's truce, when mum's got the children to bed. And he became a very respected producer and taught Clark television. And this is all very getting off the point, isn't it?
Rather too much material in front
of this. Yes, of course. And I absolutely promised the Clark family that what they wanted, Jane Clark owned the stage, but it's really her sister-in-law, Colette Clark, always known in the family as Kelly. She really is the sort of the consciences with her father, and Jane deferred to Kelly on everything. And in the end, it's really Kelly's choice. But they were both absolutely adamant the book must be within 400 pages. In fact, I mean, with all the, you know, the
dust over.
Yes, all the, you know, the curlandine and the stuff at the back, it's about 400 pages. And the publisher also. So, because you could have easily done Bebiscilia, or a Norman Sherry, and gone into three volumes, easily. You know, and I think someone like Susie Harris with Pelsner did a fantastic job, but you know, she needed, what, 800 pages to do it.
And is there a lot of material surviving
at Sotheby? Yes, quite a lot. There's no rhyme or reason, really, as far as I can see, what's left at Sotheby. It just seems that when the bands arrived, they took everything they could find, everything they could see, and just so much there, and it was just so many cupboards, and that just what didn't get taken away was left behind. There was some sensitive material, but I can't work out whether that was just a mistake or not. Probably it was just a mistake.
And maybe it's just some civilization material that takes about 10 years ago. And one thing that sounds like is how much it was, and it hasn't been collected. But I noticed you gave everything with that. I was somewhat surprised to know that there was some material.
Well, the two sort of separations, Merrill Sequest took a quite a big tranche of very important papers, all the early papers to America, and then out at Itati. And I think I was a month at Sotheby looking through the papers there, and you know, probably could have done 2 months easily. So the Tate is, I mean, just to put it in perspective, the catalogue alone of the Tate archive runs to 700 pages. Imagine how daunting this was.
And don't you write about somebody who penned their own biography?
Well, I think it's always very difficult, isn't it, when somebody, everything you want to say, they've said it already and more beautifully than you could ever possibly say it.
That's not true.
But on the other hand, he's writing about other people usually, so most of it I could, you know, I'd have to avoid.
You seem quite good at reasoning out where his own memory had failed. The first meetings with
Barrett and the like. Yes, and I think that one of the problems, I've seen this before with extremely clever people, David Rylance was another one, they have such good memories that they think they can write it all down without checking the facts. And of course, he didn't check anything very much, and the result was he did get into a muddle. And in some ways, very quite mythopoetic. I mean, you know, some of the events just either didn't take place. Or meetings that didn't happen, but he would like to have happened. We all do this, I don't know. Or he just completely changed the emphasis. I mean, his most typical example was his trip to Ireland in the middle of the war with De Valera. And I mean, was he really sent out to negotiate the Channel ports with De Valera? Of course he wasn't. He went out there as the guest of John Betjeman, and Betch introduced him to Dev, as he called him. He got on very well with Dev, and they talked about poetry, and you know, they found him very sympathetic because they.
I think she got me written in this or something.
But clearly, at some point, the Channel ports came into the conversation. You probably remember the Channel ports were given away by part of the separation agreement was that Britain would have England, or what you want to call it, had the ports, four ports, and then Chamberlain gave them away at the end of the negotiation. Dev said, you got the Channel ports as well. And Chamberlain said yes. And of course, Churchill was absolutely incandescent. They were desperate to get them back. So it was a very important matter. And it would never have been left to, you know, someone from the Ministry of Information to negotiate. But, you know, it clearly came up. He went and reported back to Churchill, you know, but it's a typical example of how history can be rewritten.
Can I ask a slightly unfair question, perhaps? Yeah. No, which is, well, two, but not very. Given that there's the other biographies and his own autobiography, do you have a sense of what a certain Clark? And is there something, is there an element of him that you feel you want to bring out that was different to what people have brought up previously?
Well, I think that, well, the the story that hadn't been told was the story of his public life. I mean, his love life had been dealt with, his peculiar private life, by Merrill Secrest. But Merrill wasn't an art historian, and I don't think she engaged with intellectual history very much. She's a professional biographer, she was writing about the man, but she wasn't interested in the public life. And the public life, you know, is quite challenging because it's writing about committees, and it is, we all know how boring that can be. But the outcomes of what is so extraordinary, I mean, I think, you know, the question I could never understand was how he ever managed to get anything done, because there were so many committees. But he turned the committees to such good account. I mean, the achievements were astonishing. I don't know, I think about public arts agenda. I think this was what Kenneth Clark achieved on committees. And in the beginning, he was very anti-committee. Before the war, he was generally conceived as a dictator, believing that a committee should have one person on it and a few yes people. And then he probably agreement with that idea. But he's but the war changed it so much, and of course the war, the committee achieved a sort of mythical importance, you know, like sort of, you know, and he, I think he very much sort of then became the, sort of turned himself into the perfect committee man, and then he became the person everybody wanted on that committee, and he knew how to run committees in the sense that he knew never to be the first to talk. He always did his research very carefully. He always had a plan. And he always thought it out very, very astutely. And it was always his word that counted. Everyone waited for Kenneth Clark to speak.
Betjeman put that very well in one of the letters in that absolutely enormous Tate archive, just to give you a tiny sense of this. When he said something like, he was trying to get Kenneth Clark to support something that he wanted to do in public life. And he said, could you just sprinkle your fairy dust over this?
Must be the nighter for comma.
And did that bring up the particular challenges as a writer? It's not writing about all the glamorous people he knew in the 1930s, one kind of writing about committee work and what he's doing on the ATV.
I found actually rather interesting writing about committees because nobody else wrote about committees. And I really found it fascinating. And his work at the National Theatre has just completely got forgotten. Everyone's heard of Littleton and Cottesloe and Olivier, but you know, he's just written out of the story. So I was incredibly pleased to bring all that back. I mean, even Rosenthal, the National Theatre historian, was amazed. You know. The challenge, I find it much more challenging writing about the things what he written. I mean, trying to say that he knew about Oxford in the 20s, I mean, God, how do you deal with that generation again? And also dealing with Clark's childhood, because there he really had written so beautifully, and you know, this is that first chapter about the childhood.
It's the famous opening line, is that the...
Oh, it's heavenly, you all know it too well.
I'll watch it. In the sense of the fact that my family belonged to the class of the Idle Rich, and in those halcyon days, there could have been there were certainly certain people who were rich, and a few people who could have been either.
Speaking specifically about his father in that
community,
I think.
Yes, father.
That's a whole other.
Well, it is a masterpiece of writing that first chapter. I mean, how reliable is it? We'll never know. It doesn't matter. It's about awakening of thought and feeling. And you know, the passages about Eichern are really magical. But even things he hated, like shooting, and it's through shooting that we really learn that this is a very sensitive soul that goes completely against his father at a very young age and refuses to go shooting. I mean, that's quite a thing, you know, for a 12-year-old boy in the 1920s,
and only child,
actually the 1910s, to actually do, an only child. There's a rebel already, but you know, he describes shooting. I don't know, read a better description, a more poetic description of what happens on a shoot, even by someone who hated it.
And
And one final question before we move on to the Gothic Revival. And you wouldn't have guessed it from this audience this evening, but he tends to divide opinion. People tend to love him or hate him.
Yeah.
What if you met with any resistance in
well, I was looking for it, I couldn't wait to find it. I was almost putting ads in the Guardian. Yeah, I was absolutely thrilled because I a lot of people who I was told were sceptical about it. I was told, for instance, Charles Waterfield used to do imitations of it, and when I got Charles into lunch, he said, "No, I worship the man." Brown Sewell, you know, came out in public with all kinds of vile statements. I got Brown into lunch, and Brown said, "Well, he just refused to have his lunch, and we came to Saltwood." It was all personal. I found someone who actually found a tutor at Westminster University who'd been railing against Clark in lectures. So this is it. I found somebody who hates Clark. And of course, would this man go on record hating Clark and loathing his whatever all his work? No. No, nobody would. It was very disappointing. But there were. But there were, you know, there were the famous dissenters of Civilisation. Williams and others, so you know they were all in print, but no, I was waiting for some shock interviews.
I tried to work with Clark about 10 years ago.
Yes.
I found myself frustrated by the fact that I tended to come across people who either liked him for his social position or disliked him for the same reason.
Yeah.
And then it became quite difficult to have a conversation very often about him as a or about him in terms of his extreme visual sensitivities or other elements of him, because this element kept creeping back in, the love-hate on a one particular basis.
Well, there's a lot of scepticism about Clark, and you know, in some ways quite rightly. I think a lot of scepticism here at the Courtauld, but it didn't seem no one from the Courtauld would speak to me about Clark. I don't know whether that was just they had nothing to say, or they didn't want to say it, I couldn't tell. But Clark certainly thought was academic prejudice against him. But he, you know, it was his own fault, really. I mean, he describes, you know, scholarship as like knitting.
And particularly with the War Against you on certain
things. Yeah, it was in Marlon's letter to Janet. It was the Hades of futility, all these wraith-like souls in the war games. And if you were Nick Cheney, sort of like a wraith-like figure, futility of Hades.
And with that means we should move on to see what
happens next. It's actually a really nice point to start to think about some of Clark's earliest projects and then how they flowed through into Clark as a public advocate for art in a very particular way. And there's a really fine working definition that Clark comes up with that you quote in the book about what a good art historian is. So maybe this is an interesting way to not necessarily counteract the riff, but think through in a different way. So here's a good art historian, right? Imagination, sympathy, responding to works of art, knowing how to use documents, and telling the truth.
This was, I think, said for children's radio.
Yeah, but it works for us. Yeah, it works for us. And so with that in mind, I wonder whether or not we could speak for a moment about what was happening for Clark when he embarked on his first book, when he was in his 20s, in art historical terms too, kind of, if not childish, at least childlike, certainly beginning to open his eyes to capacity for being able to communicate in public about art. So when you started to delve into looking at Clark's relationship to the Gothic Revival, what did you discover? What did you make of that?
Well, the first thing that realized he didn't look.
Yeah.
It's a sort of, it's a literary exercise. And his eyes were shut. He starts the Gothic Revival because C.F. Bell, Charlie Bell, was in love with him, has these notes and suggests it as a subject, and he addresses it very much as an intellectual and as a writer and as a theoretically, and addressing the theoretical basis of the Gothic Revival, which is very, very important. But he doesn't actually engage with the buildings themselves. He engaged with the House of Parliament a bit. And that is the flaw in the book, because although it's an incredibly lucid exposition of the philosophical background. As one reviewer said, he stormed the ramparts, but he didn't take the citadel. He lost his nerve, and just at the point when he started the Gothic Revival, it was a sort of Strachian irony. These things had to be explained. I mean, we know they're horrible, these buildings, but you know, they're worth explaining. And he learned so much in the course, and you said it at the beginning, a bit like Ruskin and modern painters, that by the time he got to the end, he was beginning to realise that actually these were great buildings. But you look in vain for any mention of people like Pearson or Butterfield or Scott or Street. And Scott's mentioned as a rather cynical commercial figure, when his eyes were simply closed, although he does discover Pugin, and he does a complete sort of 180-degree turn on Pugin. At the beginning, he thinks Pugin's, you know, a sort of embarrassing figure. And he afterwards says, the only point of my book is the discovery of Pugin. In fact, as we all know, someone else has done that already in Germany, but that's beside the point. But what do you think, Ayla? I mean, is talking about the Gothic Revival than I do.
Well, one of the things that was quite exciting that you brought up in the book about Clark's 180 about Pugin in particular was that one of those early moments when he starts digging around for extra research to flesh out the material that Bell had given him, is that he writes this apologetic letter to someone who can help him find out about Pugin, and he says, I'm so sorry to trouble you about this, because isn't he an awful architect? And then a few years later,
passage Hayden, the painter.
and then a few years later, he ends up presenting a copy of this book to none other than the future Queen Elizabeth. And what he says about Pugin then is, Pugin's very fascinating.
A most interesting character.
So it makes me wonder, too, about the relationship a little bit more broadly between Clark in the early 20th, mid-20th century, and the Victorians. And in particular, if we can come back to this and tease it out a little bit, Clark and Ruskin, what do you think the relationship is between those two giants?
Well, there is no Clark without Ruskin. Clark discovers Ruskin at Winchester, and he discovers everything about Ruskin. He discovers the social writings, he discovers the architectural writings, the painting writings, the natural, and I think he's sort of almost, he's intoxicated by Ruskin. But above all, it's this message of Ruskin that art is for everybody and that ugliness is a sin. And this chimes with Clark. I mean, he hasn't really thought it through, but it sort of percolates within him. And Ruskin, in a way, is the god behind the Gothic Revival. But Clark is always, in a sense, every book he does, there's a bit of Ruskin in it, and he's sort of reusing Ruskin in a different way. And his whole life is a sort of, in a sense, of he's sort of reinterpreting Ruskin in different parts of Ruskin. You know, that's even articles of Ruskin in it. You know, Clark's politics are all Ruskinian. I mean, everything about Clark, you know, his passion for Turner. You know, at every point, there's always Ruskin. He even, of course, did his famous Pietas of Ruskin, Ruskin's Grey. And he introduced Poterica. So I think Ruskin is absolutely crucial, but back to Ayla's point, Clark the Victorian, because there are so many elements to the brew in Clark, and he begins as this Victorian figure, Victorian prejudices, and then gradually you see all these influences coming in. It's like some fusion cooking. You know, you have Bloomsbury, Roger Fry. You then have his discovery of the German artistry, Riegel, Werfen, and then his Damascene moment when he goes to a lecture by Warburg. And all these elements are sort of going around. Then, of course, there's Walter Pater. Pater's the other Victorian element in this, and Hazlitt less so, but from Hazlitt and Pater and Ruskin, he takes this sense of observation and also this sense of art history as literature. I mean, in a way, they're critics, and there is this element of Clark the critic, which I probably didn't go into enough, I think, in my book. But I think Pater has it less so, and Ruskin are the foundation on which he builds and is this peculiar house.
There's another nice connection there, too, thinking about art criticism and also thinking about art patronage. And to bring out, because you were you mentioned not only Pater and all these Grand Victorian people, but also Clark's encounter with the Germans, and he does go and hear Abby Warburg lecture. And I love this little passage from Clark's impressions of what that experience was like. And he said that it was like riding in an intellectual Grand National.
He also has the inappropriate simile.
And thinking about the relationship between these grand figures in the 19th century and what Clark does to open out art for the 20th century and making our way through the arc of history that he was able to pass through in all sorts of extraordinary ways, touching on so many different institutions. One of the things that comes across again and again is this idea of popularizing without being populist. And maybe that's the turn that we could take. So, Michael, you're talking about Clark and war. Clark's eyes were opened to the power of art in its widest sense over supposedly ordinary people. So, and I wonder whether or not you could speak for a bit about how that sense of opening art up to the public, especially perhaps as soon as he gets to the National Gallery in the mid-1930s and then what happens afterwards, how that has something very particular to tell us about Clark and art for the people.
Well, Clark, the war is absolutely crucial. The war changes Clark dramatically. Before the war, the National Gallery, Clark is very much the boy of the Grand Trustees, and he's very much the same young, rich wunderkind, very much an elite figure. And the war opens up all these extraordinary opportunities. None of them are planned, but one of the paradoxes is that the National Gallery becomes popular for the first time in its history when it's empty of pictures.
Full of music.
Well, Clark brilliantly exploits the opportunities of the war. He sees that the values for which the country is allegedly fighting were best expressed through art and literature and music, and he makes the National Gallery the centre of what you might call the cultural resistance to Hitler. And I mean, he expects the National Gallery to be taken over, everybody does, and he's astonished when everyone takes it over. At that point, Myra Hess arrives in his office and asks to give a concert. He said, no, not one concert, one every day. And that's the first thing. And then to the war artists. So the war artists are so important because this is connecting with people who've never looked at art before, and he deliberately chooses subjects which are going to relate to what people are doing every day in war. And of course, a classic example, I think, is Laura Knight's famous picture, wonderful picture of Ruby Loftus, who was this girl who was a very moving picture in a way. She was bombed out of the East End, and she goes to Wales to a munitions factory where she has this extraordinary skill doing the most complicated thing you can do with shells. And she achieves this sort of master status, age 22. And there she is, grimly determined, with a thing around her head. And it's sort of a painting that everybody could relate to. And if, you know, you could feel this sort of incredible sentiment about this picture. And it was this ability of the war artists to, I think, make painting seem relevant. It was all over, by the way, at the end of the war. Everyone lost interest in painting completely. But from those 4 or 5 years, people really did come all over Britain to these exhibitions in their hundreds. And then there were other elements. There was the, when they bought the Margarita Tripp, the second Margarita Tripp painting, Mortimer Wheeler wrote to the Times saying, can't they show it even in the empty National Gallery? And this triggered a thought with Clark that maybe when they could bring up a picture every month, just one picture. And it was sort of, it was so totemic. People devoured these paintings. They were chosen Noli Me Tangere, symbolic, Hegelian, subject matter that was sort of going to somehow resound. And it was all these things that made the gallery so important.
I remember, he was quite keen that German music continued to be played.
Yes, he and Myra Hess, and Myra Hess was terrified, because being German herself, she thought she was going to be booed, and in fact, the opposite. Everyone stood up and clapped her. You know, she was a heroine of the hour in every way. They insisted on German music. The BBC had banned all German opera because you couldn't have any German. The BBC had this weird idea that you shouldn't put serious music on in wartime. It was all light music. And I think they realised after a bit this was madness. So the only place you could hear Beethoven and Bach and Brahms was the National Gallery. And I think they expected 200 or 300. It was 1,000 turned up. And you paid sixpence. And there were all these people in uniform. All the musicians were in uniform themselves. And I think everyone felt that they knew what they were fighting for. And Clark said when he heard Jesus of Joy of Man's Desiring and the Appassionata, he said, my blood ran cold. He said, I knew why we were fighting. You know, he said it was a spiritual feeling to everybody. And the rooms were, Ian Foster spoke about how moving those empty rooms were in water, and they had extraordinary nobility. And hearing this Beethoven wafting up and all these people in uniform, it was extraordinary. Everyone who went to those concerts speaks about them in these extraordinary moving tones. So, and you know, I think Clark somehow caught the mood. I mean, Cyril Connolly said in Horizon, would we be ready for any culture in the war but for Kenneth Clark?
The capacity to be able to touch people's lives in that moment of urgent crisis and be able to draw them further into themselves and further into a sense of purpose and community through marshalling the spaces that he was in to create that kind of art environment makes me think of the very different kind of space of Civilization as a series.
Well,
and it
yes.
seems like a nice link, even though we've got to jump through time.
Well,
because of time.
Maybe we can see the same way by... I think people sometimes forget how many broadcasts there were before Civilization, how many presents on television before now.
Well, this was all the products of J. Michael Reddington. He made 65 TV programmes before Civilization, and he actually got much bigger audiences than ATV. I mean, they came out of Lou Grade, who recognised when something worked, and Clark had met Lou Grade when he was. This astonishing position he had as the first chairman and the inventor of independent television, and Clark as the creator of the People's Television. It's strange and doxy.
The People's Television is certainly one thing, and it's amazing just to know how many different programs you made before this big Civilization moment. But I really need to know, how many people do you think tuned in to the program, Is Your Cornice Necessary?
Very important. That one actually sadly never got made.
What is good taste?
That had an audience of 3 million. And that went into the first round of Civilization, because it was BBC Two and everybody had BBC Two, it was only 1 million. So they went out at 10 o'clock at night live, these programmes. You can imagine those live programmes. They all had a big dinner at a station hotel beforehand, and Clark said, I'll do the wine. and then go on live doing these programmes, you know, after having drunk a great deal, and it sort of passes another country.
What is sensational to me is as much as Civilization eventually is that one, the first of all, is everything being couched in question, but also they're not art historical questions. This is not an art historian trying to popularize art historians are interested in, but instead choosing questions that he thinks people are more interested in and then answering them for them.
Absolutely right. He starts normally as the sort of Clarkian antithesis. He will try and start with the sort of extreme argument against, and then he'll gradually draw the audience back to where he wants to. Although sometimes it goes the other way. I mean, in the famous Good Taste, well, you've probably seen it. There's a bad taste room and there's a good taste room. And Clark sort of suddenly realizes halfway through the line, he actually prefers the bad taste
room.
Good taste room is sort of all sort of, you know, Kettle's Yard, it's all wonderful modernist, it's all sort of farmless. And the bad taste room is sort of, it's so monstrous, it's amiable. It's ducks up the wall and monstrous oak furniture. But he says it sort of has more humanity.
And in a sense, that's what Civilization does as well, doesn't it? I mean, it doesn't ask, it uses art to answer a question about Civilization, but it
Well, again, he starts with Clark in antithesis, what he believes the most barbaric moment. I mean, no one will agree with this, but sort of 7th century. And then he tries to show how civilization was nearly snuffed out, and how it hung on this continuum. Because here we have to define, I mean, he doesn't define what civilization is, but
we'll he can't.
We'll do it for him. It's a continuum, really, of ancient Rome with Christianity. And it's clearly soon what becomes apparent is it's a Mediterranean story. The honours are divided between France and Italy. You know, the site shows are Holland, the Netherlands, Britain, Germany, and America.
And no Spain, crucially.
No Spain, God, that was troublesome. The whole Hispanic world was up in arms. They couldn't believe it. Of course, then he tried to explain it, and it got worse and worse. Even the ambassador in Venezuela had to write and say, look, please say something, you know, I've heard riots, I've had a British embassy.
What is the interesting that's grounded in the late 1960s in terms of answering a question about civilization? I mean, they admittedly it's commissioned before student uprisings, but they're filming in Paris in May 68, so they have to flee, they can't get petrol to get across the border at the end, and Michael Hill famously gets
you said we're fleeing, like, you're in 16. We're fleeing Paris.
And the other thing is, he sits in the window of the Sorbonne and says, I don't know what students want at the moment. And did you see it as a reactionary establishment response to
two things I can say. The first is the series, why was it made? It was made to sell for the TV sets. It was totally strategic. David Attenborough wanted to get colour TV established in Britain, and thought, what will the opinion formers watch? Because it had a terrible reputation. It's art, and the only art man is Kenneth Clark. I said, was there no one else? He said, no, all the others have thick German accents. Anyway, so it began as a means of selling colour TV sets, and I don't think anybody thought that there was going to be any sort of particular sort of, you know, didactic or philosophical purpose behind it. But what did emerge, I think, is that Clark's pessimism, and it does have a lot of the rude disorder of the times in it. I mean, this was when Clark was profoundly depressed. He was profoundly depressed, lived through two world wars. I think the atomic bomb had profoundly depressed him. But he saw a world in dissolution. He saw these horrible dictators, you know, Mao, baby Dr. Bao, and, you know, Pol Pot's emerging, half the world under the yoke of communism. And youth is rioting. Youth wants to upset everything of age. And there's race riots in America. No one could see their way through it. It looked as if all the values for which he stood were being thrown out the window. And nobody was standing up for himself. He was very, very depressed. But his message is that civilizations are not destroyed by barbarians. They're destroyed from within,
yeah,
by cynicism, lack of confidence. And he's trying to show, I mean, anybody who watches carefully Civilization, whereas at the end of every episode, it's very pessimistic,
yeah,
except for the one glorious century around the building of Sharch. But otherwise, every episode ends with some deeply depressing, you know, I mean, Shakespeare as the poet of sort of the nihilistic poet, the disbelief, you know, the Rococo period ends with the Don Giovanni refusing to repent, and it gets worse. So people imagine that it's actually a kind of a candy floss of civilization. It's not quite a magic carpet. It's actually profoundly depressing in some ways. And of course, the last one, he was a complete mug, was to have to end the series. And he, you know, Michael Gill made him do the credo, was very popular with the public and loathed by intellectuals.
This means that things fall apart. I mean,
that's much more eloquent. He quotes that marvellous Yeats poem, and that, I think, is really what he did feel about the world.
Well, there are occasional moments. I mean, when he talks about the new universities in which he's going to become chancellor shortly, there's a moment which, again, talking about the students, he said they're disillusioned with our institutions. To be young and disillusioned by institutions,
yes.
But, and then there's always that but. But there are these moments in which he tries to show.
It's to me a sort of ludicrous moment at the University of East Anglia. You walk into it and think, they all look well fed and bright minded to me. I think that has to be one of the more embarrassing episodes.
Also that just thinking about emotional complexity and ambiguity and that oscillation between optimism and pessimism, and how camera work seems to function in relation to that. There is something really very striking about Clark's contact with war in that episode, and how there seems to be potentially this kind of optimistic, if not escape route altogether, some way of imagining a hopeful future by turning to, how surprising, modern British art.
Do you mean like it's a strip in the end of the world?
Yeah.
Well, that's just that he walks out from his study and walks through the library, spoke to Henry Moore.
And he's at home.
To say, yes, his own Henry Moore.
We all do that.
Yes, his group at home. then he walks out as if, you know, we can't exactly be optimistic, but we can be hopeful. It's a sort of premonitory note on which he ends. But people took away a very hopeful note from Civilisation. I mean, the people, you know, the Times leader, hung like an angel, was the heading. And people were amazed by it. I mean, there were the critics, mostly Cambridge academic, mostly Marxist, but they were, you know, their criticisms were actually very sound and perfectly true, most of them. But, you know, generally, people were ecstatic. I mean, it's partly due to they never watched a 13-part series on television. I mean, there used to be, there were Civilisation parties, because, you know, there were only people up at the manor house having a colour television. So we were always going up, this is sort of a legend of Civilisation, and Evensong was postponed.
Before we open it for questions, do you think the popularity of Civilisation derives from what it's actually saying, or from what it does to television, or from the visual qualities of it?
Well, the book, you miss everything. Of course, you miss the music, which is so important to the series, the visuals. He hated the idea of the book. Jane refused to do the book until Jane then realized she could, as he put it, give the book to her hairdresser for Christmas. So he then does the book, and of course he actually saves it, because the book sells 3 million copies, and he actually is financially saved by the book. John Murray does it for the BBC, and I don't know what he would have been economically, he would have had to sell the term probably. But what did people, everyone had different of Civilisation. I think it did give people something they didn't have. I mean, Tom Russell, the critic of the New York Times, got Maxwell lyrical about it. He said, you know, the man on the Clapham Omnibus stood taller because he felt that he was the heir of Michelangelo and Dante. Well, did he?
And about criticism as well, I may be misremembering this, but those long, sensuous shots to beautiful music where you just get to look. And I'm thinking, in America, they cut those long shots because those are the commercial breaks.
Yes.
So it was quite a different way of experiencing.
I knew a lot of people who, one of them in particular I knew, who had absolutely no education at all, for whom Civilisation really was an education. I remember her sort of telling me how she cried watching the St. Francis programme, and she was so moved, and to think of all this, what she'd missed in her life, and all this travel. And for her, Civilisation filled the gap that so much in her life had not been there. And there was that nice story of John Drummond. John Drummond was rather pompously holding forth at a sort of dinner party. I mean, Clark may be good on art, but does he know anything about, you know, sort of, you know, economics and history? And he was cut short by this journalist, the Economist, who said, look, he said, my father came from a very simple background. He's never been interested in art. He saw Civilisation and said, I want to come to London and go to the National Gallery. That was the effect of Civilisation.
On that note,